I think we perhaps have to start with the regional crisis in, with the national crisis in Mali, which is the result of domestic, political, economic, we could even say development, governance failure. And these were compounded with regional instability, regional spread of violent extremism. I think we could probably sum up the drivers by those domestic and regional dimension. And the result now is that we have this phenomenon that we call violent extremism that has spread from northern Mali to the center of the country. And then it spread to the north of Burkina, the west of Niger. And as we know from the news over the past few weeks, the phenomenon has now also moved to the north of some coastal states such as Benin. So we are literally facing now an expansion of the phenomenon beyond Mali, beyond even G5 Sahel countries, Mali, Burkina, Niger, Chad, and Mauritania, which calls for perhaps a redefinition of what we consider the regional response. So when we talk about the G5 Sahel, a lot of people actually think only of the joint force of the G5 Sahel, which was created in 2017. It's important to remember that the G5 Sahel has at least two components. One is the permanent secretariat of the G5 Sahel states that was created in 2014, and the other component is the joint force that was created in 2017. I believe this is important to be highlighted, because the response to instability in the region requires, of course, some security measures, but it also requires tackling deeper structural issues linked to governance, linked to development, linked to the way in which the population feels included within the state. And that goes through probably a redefinition of the relationships between the central state and population living in periphery areas of those states that are currently touched by high level of insecurity. There are at least two ways to look at the impact of the G5 Sahel on the larger African peace and security architecture. There is, I guess, a normative way, and there is perhaps a more creative way of looking at it. So the normative way is to say that this coalition is contributing to the fragmentation of the collective security arrangements that were put in place since the beginning of the years to 2000. But I guess a more creative way of looking at this is to see ad hoc coalitions. And in that, we have to put not just the G5 Sahel construct, but also the multinational joint task force against Boko Haram that was put in place in the Lake Chad Basin. And these basically illustrate that the African standby force, that component of the African peace and security architecture, as initially imagined, is outdated. It's important to say that because APSA, to be efficient, need to be able to tackle the evolution of security threats on the continent. And as such, it then requires, if not a flexible architecture, then at least a flexible way of thinking of this architecture. And in that sense, ad hoc coalition could be seen as a hybrid response. Hybrid in the sense that it combines dimension of both the African standby force and what is called the ASERC, the African capacity for immediate response to crisis. And the two dimensions that I'm thinking about is the regional base of the African standby force and the ad hoc coalition of the willing that is included in ASERC. So we can basically see ad hoc coalition as combining these two dimensions. And in that sense, and in addition to the fact that they are authorized by the Peace and Security Council of the African Union, we could see them as, in a way, included in the African peace and security architecture. For sure, it's not the way in which this was conceived initially. It's not also the way in which it's included in the various scenarios that are currently in the PSC protocol. But as often, institutional frameworks are often lagging behind the reality on the ground, and that's probably a more constructive way of seeing the situation.